I have no concern, I definitely agree that Hindu to others Muslims, that it produces the Muslim as an object of hatred. This is absolutely true, right? But I also think it's too preliminary, you know, to talk of, talk in terms of othering if you're talking of Hindutva. So it's not so much wrong as too little. So what is in really in question is, what is the precise form of othering involved in Hindutva? Yeah. And here I would prefer to say, to put it very briefly first, that Hindutva is engaged in the othering known as racism, right? And specifically that Hindutva today is engaged in the form of othering that I would describe as a racist populism. And I do think that this term racism describes Hindutva much more accurately than either communalism or majoritarianism. And I don't use the word racism as a term of abuse, right? Because I don't think this, I think these are analytical terms also, right? As much as they're terms of justice, but questions of justice are inseparable from questions on analysis. So that's the broad outline of the broad answer, the brief answer, the nutshell answer. But really, you know, your question is so complex that it deserves a lot of unpacking, right? And so what I'd like to do is, you know, again, go like step by step. And let's begin with the concept of othering, right? And the concept of other is very helpful precisely because it can go in so many directions. Right? Very simply put, to other is to treat as radically and fundamentally different. Right? And if you contrast this with the way we usually imagine a community, in terms of similarities, you know, we can, whether of language or culture or ethnicity or some other thing, then you create an us, right? And when we focus on similarities in this way, we make our differences something private, something that can have no meaningful part in the collective or public parts of our life. And in its own way, that's perhaps as violent. Yeah. And I'll come to that in a minute. Right? That's perhaps part of the violence of what I would call the equality of similarity. Yeah. But let's just before that, just dwell a bit more on the concept of the other. Because I think it's very, very important to remember that the concept of the other can go in two entirely different directions. You know, it's very striking that there are two very well-known books with the same title, Time and the Other. One is by an anthropologist, Johannes Fabian. The other is by a philosopher, Immanuel Levinas, right? And they are dealing with two completely different senses of the other, right? That Levinas is concerned with the othering involved in according a greater respect than is possible within the language of similarity. Yeah. Without othering, without treating others as incommensurably different, it is difficult to acknowledge the singularity of the person that we are with, the persons that we are in a community with, right? So if you extend the sense that Levinas is teasing out, and Levinas is by far from the only one, right? The other, to other can be a, to recognize the mystery, the unknowability of, that is, you know, marks even those that we are most intimate with. The other in this sense is quite compatible with and even essential, I would say, to democratic reason. Yeah? This is the othering that says that you are fundamentally different from me in ways that I will never quite comprehend. And I cherish this difference. And I would like to build a community around this difference. I do think that some of the most, you know, if you just, someone just has to think of our personal lives, right? That, you know, I mean, some of the most powerful relationships are built, most meaningful relationships are built precisely around somebody who is another, right? Around people who are others to us in some pleasurable, unique way that makes them unique. If I could replace X with Y, then you know, why would I particularly care about X rather than Y? Yeah. But by contrast, there can also be an antagonistic othering, right? An othering which says that you are so different from me that I can never build a community with you, that you're my enemy, that you're my inferior, right? And so what Fabian was tracing was his inferiorizing othering involved in colonialism, which places the colonized in a time different from the time of the modern, right? Now, I don't think it's entirely accidental that, you know, Levinas is focusing primarily on the individualized other, and the Fabian is focusing on the collective other, on a society or a group that is other. With modernity, it has become increasingly difficult to other a collective in a deeply respectful sense. Right? You know, Levinas himself is a good example of this difficulty, perhaps, you know, because you know, it is difficult to characterize, to call his characterizations of Palestinians as anything but racist. You know, so I mean, for all his talk of the other, suddenly when it came to Palestinians, you know, all that racism also surfaced, right? And that his racism was not paid attention to before this is, if anything, only symptomatic of the way that a certain kind of Eurocentrism is pervasive in academia. Right. But this is not to say that collective othering is necessarily bad. I would even say that a distinctive othering, an othering that allows, which treats a collective other as part of community, yeah, is essential for democracy. Let's call it democratic othering. Yeah? The democratic othering is that is simply put a recognition of the fact that we do not inhabit a world that is born only of similarities. We are, you know, as Hannah Arendt says somewhere, you know, born in a world which is strange. Right? We begin in strangeness. We make our home in strangeness. Strangeness is there in our intimate relationships. Strangeness may be there in some of the communities we encounter, right? So, both in the communities that we consider our own and the communities that we consider different from us, right? Democratic othering would involve treating the strangeness in the spirit of liberty, equality, and fraternity, and not making this othering only a matter of private life, right? And I would say that I'm not saying something that's completely new. You know, I mean, my first book was on Adivasis, and I spent a considerable amount of time at that time, and even since then, with progressives who work with Adivasis, right? And I will confess that I look with affectionate irritation at some of the ways that these progressives talk of Adivasis, right? Affectionate because, you know, because a lot of them do other Adivasis. Yeah. You know, and I say it's affectionate because this othering is driven by a need to respect the difference of the community. Right. It's driven by a democratic spirit. And I say it's irritation because there are also lapses, you know, in this kind of othering, right? And then it can become undemocratic. Yeah. I look with even more irritation at, but as much affection at Gandhi's othering of Muslims. You know, and in both the case of the progressives or in the case of Gandhi, it can be argued that whether successful or unsuccessful, it is an effort to build a community of equals based not only on similarity, not only on repressing and making private of differences, but on having differences in the public sphere. Right? I'm not saying it worked. Right. So I do think it's a, you know, democratic othering is an especially fraught project. Yeah. It's something that has to be approached with the greatest caution. But I'm just saying that one has to recognize that something called democratic othering is important. at least as a horizon. And I would say that, you know, you also see democratic manifestations of this kind of collective othering also in the way that ways that subaltern communities other themselves in relationship to the dominant. Right? That say, for example, if you look at the insurgent othering of Dalits in Dalit literature or poetry, an othering that insists that there's a difference to Dalits which will not go away and which will not be subordinate either. That too is a democratic othering. And if you think about these democratic manifestations of collective othering, you will notice another feature, which is that even though they may identify elements of culture as what makes them different, right? Say, for example, that there are cultural differences. Culture is not something that precedes politics here. It's not that there is a Dalit culture which precedes politics. It is rather that there is a culture that comes into being through politics. So, and I do think that, you know, this kind of othering based on a culture that is inseparable from politics, on lifestyles, by culture, I just mean the very, very loosely here, the conglomerate of ways that we, you know, live politically also, right? You have to fashion forms of democratic othering. Yeah. And democratic othering, democratic self-othering, and ways of democratically questioning this othering. I mentioned democratic othering first before getting to your question about Hindutva, because I wanted us to have this on the horizon when talking of the viciously non-democratic othering. Yeah. Involved in Hindutva. Right? Because if we do not have this as an alternative, democratic othering as an alternative, then we get into saying, no, no, you shouldn't other, we should all be part of anas. Right? So it is important to begin by saying that we have to have a space for a democratic othering. Otherwise, we'll not have an adequate language in which to envision equality. And you know, this is where I think to think of a democratic othering is to introduce a very distinctive equality, which, you know, in this article that I think I shared with you also, I call the equality of who, right? Or the equality of difference, right? You know, our usual concept of equality has been well described by Amartya Sen, who talks of an equality of what. By this, he means that there is one criteria in terms of which we think equality, and it is our equality along this one criteria that allows all our other differences. Right? For example, you know, if I'm thinking of the way democracies function, we allow for it is a primacy of the political equality that allows for all the other inequalities. Right? And then if I'm a right-wing liberal, I'll say that all that matters is formal equality. And all the economic inequalities that flow from this are secondary. Yeah? So how I interpret equality, a lot depends on that. But it can also be quite empowering. Right? If I introduce questions of equity in addition. So I'm not, and I would say that if you are thinking of questions of economic, social, racial equity, then an equality of what is absolutely crucial. So I'm not for a movement suggesting that those of us committed to a radically democratic politics should give up on the equality of what. The equality of what is at the heart of our world of rights and entitlements. And without rights and entitlements, the weakest in society would only be more vulnerable. Yeah. But still, I would say that despite this, precisely because it is grounded in a commonality, in a similarity, the equality of what also represses and makes impossible the more radical ways of conceiving difference and equality, the kind of equality involved in democratic othering, for example. Most evidently, democratic othering, the equality of who comes into being when we encounter beings with whom we share less in common, or with whom we have shared two ways, right? Those with whom we share less in common, and those with whom we have intense relationships, right? And the, you know, I would say that any intense equality, even amongst humans, must have this dimension of democratic othering. This democratic othering, which I was calling an equality of who earlier, you know, I suspect, though I'm willing to rethink this, I suspect it cannot be embodied in institutions, in rights, in the same way. And that it has to be performed in a democratic social space. Which is not to say that institutions don't matter, because institutions can enable without necessarily, you know, instituting. And I do think that one of the things that makes Gandhi and Ambedkar such relevant thinkers for our time is that they are more intensely committed to they are some of the most, you know, again in the 20th century, in 20th century India, I think they are the greatest thinkers of the equality of who. I think it is symptomatic of the commitment to equality that both were in different ways skeptical of the state. Gandhi in his emphasis on true Swaraj rather than parliamentary Swaraj, and Ambedkar in his conversion to Buddhism after having set up the state, right? So that's the kind of broad framework within which I think we have to think of the, you know, this matter. You know, people sometimes describe Hindutva as a communalism or a majoritarianism or a religious fundamentalism, right? We've already seen that religious fundamentalism is quite inadequate. I would say similarly that communalism and majoritarianism are quite inadequate. Right? And that therefore, this is why I use the term racism. So in order to avoid this kind of confusion, in order to explain where I'm coming from, since as I said, I'm not using racism as a term of abuse, I'm just using it analytically. Let's go systematically. And to go systematically, we have to start with nationalism. Yeah? The reason I'm starting with nationalism is that, you know, obviously Hindutva is connected to nationalism. We know that very, very well. To understand Hindutva, one really has to focus a lot more on nationalism, right? And to understand nationalism, I feel that a book that is still very, very relevant is Benedict Anderson's Imagined Communities. I teach its chapters regularly in my undergraduate courses, and I think it's quite fair to say that Anderson carried out a Copernican revolution of sorts with that book in the study of nationalism. And like all revolutionary works, its implications have continued to unfold in ways that go far beyond Anderson's own formulations. Indeed, I don't think Anderson's formulations can adequately contain the implications of what he says, right? And I suspect, I'm sure you already know the answers, Anderson's arguments very well, but just to remind you, what makes Anderson's argument revolutionary is that it begins by saying that all communities are imagined, but that nationalist communities are imagined in a distinctive way, right? That they are imagined abstractly rather than particularistically. Now, of course, Anderson is far from the first to make a distinction between the abstract and the particular, right? But its implications become especially powerful in the way he formulates matters. Because what he does is, he describes particularistic communities as constituted by an indefinitely stretchable network of kinship, clientship, or any other kind of ties. He seems to imply that particularistic communities are pre-modern. I do not think this is the case at all, right? It is certainly true that particularistic communities were dominant or primary, perhaps in the pre-modern world, but they're crucial to the modern world too. When I teach undergraduates, one of the examples I use of a modern particularistic community is the idea that we know everybody in the world through at most 6 degrees of separation. So, you know, what does that mean? That basically means that I have one particular tie, and that particular tie allows me to get to another particular tie. And within 6 particular ties, I can get to anybody in the world. Right? Similarly, when we talk about how much connections matter in maintaining structures of caste privilege, race privilege, all of that. Again, we are talking of the importance of particularistic relations, right? So any idea that particularistic relations have disappeared is ridiculous. And I think it's just a kind of, a kind of bias towards development or a simplistic modernist bias that makes us even say that particularism belongs to the past. Yeah? And I'll come back to particularism in a minute. But before that, I want to say that, you know, look, a particularistic relation is very, very different from an abstract community. Yeah? Abstract community is a community where our relationship with others is constituted by mediation to some symbolic entity to which we owe allegiance, right? Whether that in Anderson's examples very famously are the map, the unknown soldier, etc. And if I were to add to what Anderson says, I would add 2 things. One, abstract communities are not new. They are quite old. 2, there is another kind of abstract community that Anderson surprisingly does not pay enough attention to. All the more considering that his brother is Perry Anderson. Right, you know, which is the kind of not exactly community, but abstraction involved in capitalism. Yeah, which too is very, very important. So that's just 2 additional remarks I'd make about the abstraction that he's talking of. The other thing that Anderson says about the nation, which I really, really want to stress, which I think, again, I don't think we pay enough attention to, is that all the members of a nation are equal. Right? This equality that one can claim as a member of a nation is what is so revolutionary about it as a modern form of sociality. Right? The symbolic equality is not meant to sweep away other social inequalities, but it's still quite revolutionary, right? Upsetting older hierarchies. You just have to remember, for example, in India, the khadi caps. And at least part of the cap, the way that the part of these caps came from the way that they were shared in common, right? They were an abstract way of representing the nation. But in addition to being an abstract way of representing the nation, they were in local relations, a way of saying to the upper caste landlord that, look, I'm equal to you, right? I'm wearing this thing that I'm not supposed to wear. And by doing so, I'm being a part of a nation. And as part of a nation, I'm sorry, I'm not going to be subordinate to you. Yeah. And as you know, people reacted, elites reacted with irritation, anger, hostility, you know, beatings, all of that, when they saw the Gandhi cap, right? From worn by formerly subaltern groups, right? So what I'm trying to say is that there were concrete ways in which, and there have always been concrete ways in which the symbolic equality of all members of the nation was performed in its early years. And of course, we still can't take the symbolic equality for granted. Right. It is part of what is being denied in the violence against lower castes or Muslims, right? Which is why sometimes good liberals who accept this kind of liberal nationalists who accept this kind of equality of the nation say, how can you treat other people of the country this way? Right? So that equality of the nation, you know, matters a lot. And as just, again, I mean, to give an example from here in the US, I was just reading last week a book by Grace Paley, you know, the activist in the civil rights movement, and she was writing about her childhood and her brother going during the Second World War. And she says that one of the things that shook him was the moment when white German prisoners of war were placed in front of the black American soldiers, right? So that in some senses, you know, nationalism was supposed to trump race, was supposed to overcome race and produce a symbolic equality, which it did not. Yeah. So I think this is very, very important to remember about nationalism, right? That it's, you know, abstract, that it's equal. Again, I'm saying equal as a symbolic equality. I don't think we need to dwell on the fact that this is not about an actual equality, right? Because that's too evident to need stressing. Third, I will say that there's a particular sense in which it is democratic. I'm using the word now, not in the sense that I used it earlier of a republican democracy, but in the very broad sense that it claims legitimacy from the demos or people by its very nature. That even states ruled by bloodthirsty tyrants or elites have felt compelled to claim the word democracy or compelled to claim the word republic, saying that they represent the true voice of the people, etc. Okay, so that's what, those are some of the key points that I would take from Anderson. But, you know, having taken this much from him, we must also part company with him, you know, and part company with him most of all on this question of race. Because I think Anderson wants to keep race at a distance from nationalism. He wants to believe that, you know, racism belongs to another world altogether from nationalism. Yeah. And that, I think, is quite mistaken. Balibar has a wonderful essay in this book, Race Nation Class, where he points out that nationalism as a concept never functions alone, right? That it is always part of a chain, in which it is both central, yeah, and the weak link. I want to stress this, you know, both the central link and the weak link, right? In other words, what this means is effectively that nationalism is constantly being supplemented by other phenomena, that there is no such thing as a pure nationalism, right? That anytime you analyze any nationalism, you have to pay attention to the supplements of nationalism. And unless you pay attention to the supplements of nationalism, you're not really talking of nationalism in any concrete sense. Yeah? Because nationalism as a formal structure has only these three elements, right? Abstraction, equality, and the invocation of the demos. But the point is, how do you think abstraction? How do you think equality? How do you enact abstraction, equality, demos, people? That depends on the supplement. And unless you pay attention to the supplement, you will not get a sense of how that works. Yeah. So I think, you know, I don't know whether it's a comprehensive list of supplements, but there are some supplements that I would really like to draw attention to, right? And six supplements, really. Communalism, majoritarianism, racism, racist populism, liberalism, and democratic populism. And since our focus is on Hindutva, I'll talk more about the first three, you know, than about liberalism and democratic populism. First four, right? And leave the last next two, maybe for some other occasion that we talk or something. Yeah. And I say, so these six, let's begin with communalism. Yeah. It's been long recognized that communalism and nationalism are connected. The word communalism itself is actually peculiar to the Indian subcontinent. Right? You know, Gyan Pandey shows in his book that, you know, this, that it really gains purchase during the Indian nationalist movement. For the Congress nationalists, communalism represented a bad nationalism, which placed community above the nation. And to think of communalism as only a bad nationalism is completely unhelpful. Yeah. Because, you know, all the more so now that we recognize that nationalism is incomplete in itself. It is a weak link which must be supplemented in some way or the other. Right? So that's definitely true. But at the same time, I want to stress that I don't want to dismiss the concept of communalism as an error. Right? I think the concept of communalism captures something very, very important, which is the phenomenon of patriotism. Yeah? And many have suggested a contrast in relationship between patriotism and nationalism. For example, my late teacher, the absolutely brilliant Chris Bailey, right? And if you had to sharpen that contrast, take it in maybe even more conceptual directions than Chris himself does entirely, then we might say, remember what Anderson said, and we might say, patriotism is a notion of place and community sustained by particularism. Right? That is to say, whereas the nation is a place and community sustained by abstraction. Patriotism is a notion of place and community sustained by particularism. Thus, for example, when you think of the pre-modern Maratha or Bheel or Sikh identities, I think it is fair to call them patriotic. So that is one way. The other way to actually describe patriotism and to bring out its distinctiveness from nationalism would be by focusing on the question of equality. Because remember what I said about nationalism, what Anderson said about nationalism, that it is equal, that it has this rhetoric of equality, more correctly put. You know, it's true that Maratha, Bheel, and Sikh polities arguably had a more egalitarian culture than parts where the sense of patriotism was not too strong. But we can't make too much of this, right? This is an egalitarianism that is quite compatible with hierarchy. Yeah? That, you know, for example, as you know, in the Maratha kingdom, caste hierarchies were very, very strong, right? Hierarchies within chieftains were very, very strong. Chiefs had followers, right? So this kind of hierarchical patriotism is part of what is undercut, where nationalism becomes more prevalent, right? Because nationalism has this abstract identity, which is very, very different. And it goes both ways, that, you know, the conservative patriots, the more careful conservative patriots, more thoughtful conservative patriots, are often upset by nationalism. It's very, very striking that, for example, Burke's objection to the French Revolution, I think one could say, is because he sees in it a nationalism that is coming to displace the patriotism that he associates with Britain. Right? And he senses that where patriotism comes, it becomes quite difficult for nationalism to, you know, where nationalism comes, it will supplant patriotism. It will make patriotism much more difficult. Again, I seem to remember reading, I wish I had a reference for this. It's a long time since I read, but that you know, Hitler was similarly hostile on the other side to patriotism, right? That he wanted a nationalism. So extrapolating from the insights that Bailey offers and many others since then, I'm tempted to suggest that what is called communalism is also better understood perhaps, or is also understood as articulating a patriotism. Yeah. So the patriotism coursed through some of the broader, reconstituted broader identities of Hindus and Muslims from around the 19th century. And communal confrontations and communal, quote unquote, communal riots until at least the 1970s, 1980s were also often drew on these particularistic connotations, drawing on very, very specific ties. And specific does not mean local, just to remind you, right? Very, very specific allegiances and hierarchies that created their own far-flung networks, you know. I was a journalist after my high school for 5 years in the mid to late 80s. And it was a time of massive communal violence in Baroda, where I was working with Indian Express. And I'm tempted to say that even as late as that, a certain particularistic logic, right, was very much there in the Hindu-Muslim conflict. I'm not saying that was the only logic, right, but that this was a crucial dimension. And I think this particularism is very, very important to keep in mind, because the reason I would call Hindutva, I would not call Hindutva communal, the reason I would not call Hindutva communal is because particularistic identities are not central to it the same way. Right? And that, I think, is a fundamental difference. So to call Hindutva communal is to use a term that's perhaps no longer as relevant, at least for Hindutva. I'm not saying that communalism has disappeared. I'm just saying that for understanding Hindutva, communalism is not the analytical category. Right? The second thing to keep in mind is talking of majoritarianism. And, you know, this concept has sometimes been used to, has been drawn on to describe Hindutva. And again, my feeling is that the term is not adequate to describe Hindutva. And, you know, we need to understand what majoritarianism is. And I think we have to remember that, you know, to go back to what I said about the distinction between majoritarian and republican democracy, that, you know, even though republican democracies seek to install a majority, they seek to install a majority that nourishes liberty, equality, and friendship of fraternity. Right? And, you know, by contrast, what majoritarianism involves is what Ambedkar describes as a permanent or communal majority. And as Ambedkar points out, there is no doubt that if you think of the way much of the mainstream Congress has deployed the word communalism, especially in the years leading up to independence, right? It was often used to describe the demand for Pakistan or to describe Ambedkar's demand for separate electorates. So in these cases, the word communalism was itself being used for a majoritarian politics. Right? It was being used negatively by those committed to a majoritarian politics. Right? To say that you are communal was in some senses to affirm a majoritarian identity. And it was being used to tamp down the rights of those who are minoritized as a community by the workings of electoral and, you know, of electoral politics. Right? So I think this feature of majoritarianism is something that we really need to keep in mind. Right? Along with that, I will say that tentatively speaking, maybe one can identify two distinctive features to the way a permanent majority has functioned in India. The first is the claim to speak for the minority too. Right? I think one of the things that makes majoritarianism distinctive, especially when you look at it in retrospect with in relationship to Hindutva, is that it claims to speak for the minority too. Yeah? And, or it says that, look, there is no separate minority. In this sense, it is not necessarily so much actively opposed to the group it minoritizes, as it is convinced that it represents their true interests, that it can speak for them too. Yeah. And the striking thing about majoritarianism is this claim to be inclusive, right? That there is, we are a majority, but we are speaking even for the minorities that we are excluding. Now, you can see this very clearly in the early and mid-20th century pronouncements of upper caste Congress leaders on Dalit issues. They are saying, look, Dalits don't need separate representation because now that we have democracy, this does not matter. Right? And of course, this does not manage to go through in the case of Dalits. But the way the possibility of reserved seats for Muslims was tossed aside, in the Constituent Assembly debates, right? Not separate electorates, but reserved seats, yeah, which is briefly considered, was precisely by this kind of majoritarianism, by invoking this kind of majoritarian logic, right? And that kind of that inclusive, how do I say? So one way of describing majoritarianism then is that it is an inclusive exclusion. It excludes the minorities through the gesture of including them. Yeah. So I think this inclusive exclusion is one very useful way of describing what's going on. Yeah. The other thing to describe, other thing to remember about majoritarianism, and this I'm less sure of, but I'm at present at least I'm tempted to say this, is that it recasts the older communal and particularistic identities into the abstract form of the nation state. Right? In that sense, majoritarianism is best described as a hybrid phenomenon, right? Drawing on both the particularistic forms of patriotism and the abstract forms of nationalism. Yeah. And I would say that this kind of majoritarianism was especially powerful in Indian politics till roughly the 90s. Certainly much of the mainstream Congress, especially the non-Nehruvian elements, you know, because I think Nehru, whatever his limitations, was at least committed to Republican democracy. The non-Nehruvian elements were, in the Congress, were drawn to majoritarianism. I'm also tempted to describe some of the strands of the BJP. For example, Vajpayee, despite his membership of the RSS, as closer to the majoritarianism. If you look at his rhetoric, there is that majoritarian dimension to it. Yeah. So let's be under no confusion. I'm not for a moment suggesting that majoritarianism is not violent. Yeah. It is massively violent. But at the same time, I think one has to recognize that for analytical purposes, one has to distinguish between forms of violence. Right? And if one is distinguishing between forms of violence, then one has to say that if you're describing the BJP today, if you're describing the RSS from its inception, if you're describing Modi, then the term majoritarianism is no longer enough. Right? So how then to describe today's ideology in the 12? Right? I think in the 12 from its inception is best described not as a majoritarianism, but as a racism. And as I was saying, racism originally, today as a racist populism. Right. And, you know, I would say that to me, it seems as though Savarkar holds a premier place in Indian political thought. He's the first figure perhaps in India to articulate a systematic racism. Right. And he's arguably the most articulate racist theorist to date. He rejects the conventional understanding of Hinduism as a religion and instead redefines Hindus in terms that we would today recognize as characteristic of racism. Right? Remember his greatest innovation in Essentials of Hindutva. He provides a purely secular definition of Hindus. Right? He considers various options, if you remember. You know, first he begins by setting aside religion. Right? He decides that it's not attempt enough to try and identify Hindus as a group on the basis of shared belief about divinity or transcendent matters. Right. So remember, first of all, already there's a shift here. He's shifting from Hinduism to Hindus. Right. And then he says, look, if I look at beliefs, then I can't. If I look at Hinduism, that's not enough to talk of Hindus. So how then do I come to it? So then he comes up with four criteria. He begins with the common Pitrubhu or fatherland. And then he decides that this is not enough, since many non-Hindus can claim it too. The same problem arises with the other two criteria he considers, common blood and common Sanskriti or civilization. Right? these two can be claimed by non-Hindus, as he points out, right? So it can be claimed by Muslim and Christian converts. So finally, he decides that these are necessary, but they're not sufficient conditions. Yeah. And then he adds the decisive one, which is that Hindus are those who consider Bharat to be a Punyabhu or a holy land. And even Punyabhu is defined, you know, as you can think of it, that's a secular term, right? It's an object to something immanent, a land. Yeah. This is why I'm saying that Savarkar is a very important and even pioneering figure, even in the global history of figure, in the history of racism, right? Even in the global history of racism, because he's one of the earliest to articulate and give full-blown voice to what can be called a cultural racism, you know, incorporating the element of sacrality into culture. Yeah. You know, at the time that he writes, most of Europe and North America is still caught in a blood-based racism. Something like this is emerging already in Germany. So it's not entirely unprecedented, but the racism that he's articulating is, you know, much adopted, becomes commonplace only much later. And now you might ask, of course, what makes Hindutva a racism rather than a communalism? Yeah. And here, I think it's very, very important to remember two features of racism, of nationalism also, right? One, if you remember, nationalism involves a community that's imagined abstractly, and it's precisely such an abstract community that Savarkar has reimagined the Hindus rather than Hinduism. He specifically gives up on the criterion that would have allowed him to engage with the messiness of the actual complexities of the ways that Hindus practice their religion, the deities they worship, the various beliefs that they have, etc. If he had engaged with those complexities, he would have been compelled to engage with Hinduism in all its particularities. Right? Since he cannot deal with that complexity for his purposes, he must give up on it. Right? And that's why he comes up with these abstract criteria. Right? Each abstract in a different way, and each arguably more abstract than the others. Right? And yet at the same time, by drawing an internal line, a line that creates an internal other, it imbues this abstractness with a constant need for iteration. Right? So it's a different kind of this thing. Second, I think this is especially important for thinking of the contemporary and future trajectory of Hindutva. I think we should take note of the paradoxical, quote unquote, egalitarianism of Hindutva, right? I know egalitarianism is not a word that we associate with Hindutva at all, but just do bear with me for a second, right? So I think, you know, Balibar again puts it very, very well, where he says that the societies in which racism has arisen are egalitarian societies. And this is first and foremost an equality in respect of nationality, he says. Extending what Balibar is saying, and I think it's already there in some of what he says, one might say racism is egalitarian for the races. It's egalitarian within the races often, right? In other words, what I'm saying is that by practicing racism, races can claim an equality amongst themselves, right? We know very well that this is part of what happened with the making of whiteness in the United States, right? That it was by distancing themselves from the blacks, right? By identifying a community as black, right? That the Irish and other formerly marginal groups also claim participation in being white, made themselves white, so to speak. And I think something similar needs to be said about Hindutva, right? That especially in its Savarkarite or most clearly racist form, it allows for and encourages participation by lower castes. It tries to you know, bring about this kind of participation. Right? So in some senses, it tries to create a community of Hindus as a racialized group defined in terms of an opposition to internal and inferiorized others such as Muslims and Christians. This concerted effort, I think, to incorporate lower castes and Dalits and Adivasis is one of the most striking features of Hindutva today. And it's very striking that Savarkar, in his in a very conflicted way, you know, one of his disagreements with a lot of the more conservative Hindu nationalists is that they are not hostile enough to caste. Right? Of course, I mean, you know, this is a hostility to caste only in order to create a more a Brahminical form of Hindutva. But I think we still have to recognize it if you have to understand the distinctiveness of what's happening. Right? In other words, what I'm trying to say is that it's not enough to call Hindutva Brahminical. It is not Brahminical in the old way. Right? It is a recasting of older Brahminical traditions within a racist framework. You know, if you think of Brahminical traditions as an older form of discrimination based on one kind of othering, based on a particularistic othering, yeah, you can think of this as based on a new kind of othering, an abstract othering. Yeah. And, you know, within this abstract othering, now that it's Muslims and Christians who are the others, you know, Dalits and Adivasis can be incorporated into the Brahminical fold in a way that allows for symbolic equality, even as it perpetuates actual inequalities. Right? So it's in this very, very concrete sense that I'm calling Hindutva racist, right? In this double sense of, you know, abstraction for thinking of the community, for thinking of a specifically Hindu community, egalitarianism within the racist community, etc. Okay, so that's so let's just to review where I've reached. I have gone through you know, communalism, majoritarianism, racism. The fourth thing I'd like to talk about, and now I'll be much briefer because I think this is much better understood, is that if you're thinking of today, it is not enough to talk of racism. We have to talk of a racist populism. Yeah. Why racist populism? Because, you know, again, one of the terrifying things about racism is that racism is quite compatible with democracy. Yeah. You know, if you think of the United States till the civil rights movement, you have an example of a racist democracy. If you think of Israel today, if you think of South Africa, right? There are, within the races, there is democracy. Yeah? I mean, I think somebody's used the phrase Herren Folk democracy to describe this, but you see what I'm saying, right? That there can be democracy within the races based on excluding the subjugated, othered races. Now, so in a way, what I'm saying is that racism is quite compatible with an attenuated version of the equality of what? A severely attenuated version, that goes without saying, but it is compatible, and we have to remember that. Because, you know, otherwise we'll forget what's especially terrifying about it and why people can buy into it. But racist populism is different. Right? We've talked of the equality of who, the equality of what, right? One may say that you know, the equality of similarity and the equality of different, equality of who being the equality of difference, the equality of similarity being the equality of what, right? I would like to introduce a third term, identitarian equality. Yeah? And the reason I'm introducing this third term is because I think this identitarian equality is very, very central for thinking of populism as a concept. It will be the one key element of populism as a concept. And what I mean by identitarian equality is where I say that, look, our oneness matters more than anything else, right? It's based on a confusion of equality with identity, right? Where equality becomes synonymous with identity, right? And where that happens, you are moving into another terrain altogether. You are moving into the terrain of populism, of racist populism, right? Because I would say that there's a democratic populism, which is very, very different. So it is that kind of racist populism, which I think we are seeing with Modi, right? What that populism does is that it undercuts even the equality that racist democracies have. That, say, for example, is there in South Africa, was there in apartheid South Africa, yeah, for the whites, or was there for whites in pre-civil rights United States. Yeah. So even that becomes now difficult, right? And that is one of the striking things about racist populism. Now, I think it's too early to say whether Hindutva will necessarily stay at this level or whether it will go, or it will go to something more, right? Whether it will be stably a racist democracy or whether it will push towards a racist populism. I am tempted to say, looking at the current moment, that it seems like there's a fundamental instability in Hindutva, right? Which makes it always prone to be a racist populism rather than a racist democracy. And this may be perhaps part of the way of describing the tension between the RSS, right? And the more populist wings, that, you know, the RSS ideology is quite compatible perhaps with a racist democracy, so to speak. Yeah. Whereas what we have now is also a racist populism. Okay. So I think this is very, very important to remember. Yeah. Okay. So those are the key things that I want to talk about. I just want to quickly talk about, very, very quickly, just also mention liberalism and democratic populism. Yeah. I don't want to spend as much time on them because that's not what we've been talking, what your question is really about, but just to provide a kind of counterpoint and to think of how one can fight this or how one can oppose it, right? And let's turn to liberalism first. Yeah. And, I think we all know liberals have a very difficult time reconciling with nationalism. In part, this is because they're acutely aware that, as Michael Ignatieff puts it, if a nation gives a people a reason to sacrifice themselves, it also gives them a reason to kill, right? So it's not that liberals are particularly queasy about killing, right? The violence in the name of liberal values is immense, right? Not just colonialism, but if you want a more recent example, you just have to look to the invasion of Iraq, or you have to look to all the military actions that the Obama regime undertook, right? So, and Michael Ignatieff himself, is notorious, right, for effectively just, implicitly justifying even potentially torture, right? Or at least if not torture, being quite willing, he actually called for the invasion of Iraq, from what I remember. I hope I'm not ascribing to him things that he didn't do, but at least my memory is that he did. Yeah. The invasion of Iraq killed enough people that we can't claim any innocence for liberalism in terms of violence, right? But liberals operate with the framework that you put your finger on at the beginning of our conversation. They are opposed to what they see as the violence of passionate excess. Right. And for them, the violence of nationalism can seem cruel or excessive, unless it can also be justified in terms of a different moral calculus, such as the one that was provided for the invasion of Iraq. You know, entirely spurious calculus, but I'm just saying that there was a moral calculus provided rather than a nationalist calculus provided, right? That we are doing this for the people of Iraq. You know, Talal Asad has this lovely line in Suicide Bombing, his book called On Suicide Bombing, where he says, what is especially intriguing is the ingenuity of liberal discourse in rendering inhuman acts humane. You know, this is certainly something the savage discourse does not have. And so it sums it up. I mean, you know, what I'm trying to say is that liberals claim to reject nationalism because it's violent. What they're actually rejecting it for is more something like its potential for, you know, for the violence of passionate excess, which is basically misunderstanding, as we saw, right? And at the same time, the other aspect of liberalism is that liberals hardly reject the nation state despite rejecting the nationalism, right? Because for a start, liberals have been especially fascinated by the state, for it's in terms of the state that even the most minimal power, you know, project of individual rights must be carried out, right? Their reconciliation with the nation state has come, in a sense, through an emphasis on the powers of the state and trying to, you know, really just use the powers of the state for individual rights often. So what this means often is that they do not engage with their nationalism. It is not that they're not nationalist. Their nationalism has been repressed, not explicitly theorized. What has very often happened with liberals is that liberals slip into a majoritarian nationalism. Right? Say, for example, I mean, and I'll focus here, and we could focus also on India. It's very, very striking how the language of merit works. Right? Once you think of a language of merit, you create a natural order, which is invisible, right? That is why it's whites here and upper castes in India who are dominating this order is not necessarily as visible to liberals. It's usually not at all visible, right? So that's the sense in which liberalism formally rejects nationalism, actually ends up, you know, buttressing a majoritarian nationalism very often. Yeah. Of course, I should add one qualification because it's not entirely fair. Because when you think of the more complex liberals, people like Nehru, at their most interesting, they are talking of something else. They're talking of political equality, and they are in some senses coming towards something closer to a republican democracy, right? But I won't go into that right now. All I want to stress is that unless liberals are very, very careful, most of the time liberalism falls into majoritarian nationalism. Yeah. Let me just end by focusing on this last point, which is what I call democratic populism. Right? Because let's not forget that, you know, people like Ambedkar, and Ambedkar calls himself a patriot. Gandhi does also, right? Nehru does also. So they also have some notion of a nationalism. Yeah. And their nationalism cannot be described in terms of a majoritarian thing. Their nationalism is much more focused on, in some senses, a plurality within the people, right? And both socially, in the case of Gandhi, socially, in the case of Ambedkar, both socially and institutionally, trying to provide for spaces for such a democratic populism to thrive. And I do feel that if you have to think in the long run of how there is going to any opposition to the kind of project that is Hindutva, we cannot depend on mainstream liberalism, we have to turn to some form of democratic populism.